In today's video, we're going to talk all about tethering. Welcome back to the channel, everyone. If you're not already subscribed, if you could please go ahead and press that button, and if everybody could sign up for the bell and give me a thumbs up, I would really appreciate it. And if you guys like learning from me in these videos, you might also like learning from me on my exclusive members-only learning platform, the Academy with John Gress. And the Academy is where you'll find longer tutorials than you'll find here on YouTube. You'll also get access to a live Q&A and critique session that happens twice a month. You'll get early access to my YouTube videos, discounts on in-person workshops, and much more. So for more information and to sign up for a 3-day free trial and some discounts, just go to johngress.com/academy. So tethering can be a great way for you to refine your work on set. There's only so much you can see by looking through the EVF or looking at a small screen on the back of a camera. Just by seeing your work on a computer monitor, you might spot a distracting element sticking out of the subject's head, or you might be able to better balance your lights if you're using multiple lights in a studio. I used to try to do things just run and gun and go off the back of my camera, but I really felt that when I started tethering, it really elevated my work and took it to the next level. As a commercial photographer, tethering is pretty much just expected. The art director that you're working with or your client is gonna wanna see the work in real time, and that way they can make sure that they're getting what they need and also make corrections as needed. And this will really help speed things up on the set. They'll be able to tell you whether or not you've got the shot or you need to fix things or they need to fix things. I do a lot of beauty shoots and they're always looking at the images on screen and then going and correcting the makeup or the hair and that sort of thing. And it just helps move things along greatly. Another sort of side effect of tethering is that your clients are gonna be far less likely to come to you after the shoot and say we need to do something over because they've seen it and corrected it in real time. Now, if the person in front of your camera is your client, let's say it's an aspiring model or actor, or perhaps it's a realtor or other business person, then it's going to be great as well on those shoots. So after I shoot a series of images and I think we've got the shot for that look, I'll invite the subject over to the computer and just have them go through their images and make sure that they're getting what they want. Now, a lot of times they'll spot something that they're doing and they'll sort of say, oh, I need to fix my hair, or I need to maybe close my shirt, or maybe I need to just change how my hands are, or they might give us, the photographers, feedback as well. And that always sort of helps to ensure that they're getting exactly what they want. And then after I've made those corrections and shot some more photos, I'll invite them over to look again and just make sure that they know that there's an image in there that they're gonna like so that we can move on to the next look. And doing this sort of work on set will really probably help in the end to increase your sales on these types of shoots because the client will be happier with the work overall. So there are two ways that we can tether. We can tether wirelessly or we can use a cable. Now the disadvantages of wireless transmission, if you will, are that it's going to take a long period of time or much longer to transfer a raw file over the air than with a cable going into the side of the camera. Now I know a lot of people, a lot of companies, they'll make technology to sort of speed this up, but it's never really going to get to that same speed. But if you're comfortable and it's fine for you in your workflow, tethering small JPEGs might be a great option. Now, using that hard cable will allow you to quickly transfer raw files. And one of the great things about that is you might be able to apply a look preset directly to your pictures upon capture. And that'll help you know whether or not the lights are exactly right or the exposure is exactly right for the look that you're going for. Again, tethering is just helping us to elevate our work. So the cable that I use on my camera is a Tether Tools right angle adapter USB 3.0 to USB-C 20 inch or 50 centimeter cable. And then that plugs into a 15 foot or 4.6 meter USB-C to USB-A female adapter. I ended up with this cable because I really wanted a right angle coming out of the camera and then going straight down. And at the time that I purchased it, it was the only option. Tether Tools now makes a single cable that's USB-C coming out of the camera and USB-C going into the laptop. But one great sort of side effect of having this cable is that it solved a problem that I didn't even know it was going to solve. So a lot of times when I'm shooting handheld, I will shoot for a while, then I'll sit the camera down on the tethering cart, hopefully on a low shelf. And then what ends up inevitably happening is that I trip over the cable and rip the camera off the stand onto the floor, or the cart onto the floor. And thankfully, knock on wood, I'll have to find some a little later, maybe back there on my desk, I haven't damaged the camera any of the times that this has happened. But once I got sort of this two-piece solution, what happens is that I trip over the long cable and that pulls it out of the short cable, which I think they might also call a pigtail. And then that's the end of it. The camera stays in place, thankfully. This has happened every time and the cable just comes out. Then all I have to do is walk over there and plug it in and I don't have to look embarrassed on set or act like a tough guy on set, pretending that I don't care that my $5,000 plus camera has ended up on the floor. So the reason I'm making this video today is because of a connection problem that I had that I literally solved last night. So a lot of times if you're having trouble connecting your camera to your computer with a cable, it could be because there's a conflict. So on a Mac, you might have it set up so that when you plug in a camera, it automatically launches the Photos app. And then that would make it so that the Photos app has the signal and Lightroom or Capture One can't get it. Now, I'm not saying definitively that this is the reason. I'm just saying that something like this, for example, could be the cause. If you're using a Canon camera, for instance, their software EOS Utility is often set up, I believe, by default to launch as soon as you plug the camera in. And then what happens is it takes priority of the signal, it gets priority of the signal, and then it doesn't end up going to Lightroom or Capture One. So those types of conflicts can be the reason why you're unable to connect. Now, I used Lightroom Classic for a number of years, and I would go up there and I would come down to start tethered capture. And then what would happen is that this beach ball would start spinning and it would go on forever and ever and ever. And as I started teaching workshops, other photographers were giving me pointers, like they were saying, turn the camera off, then launch the capture, tethered capture, and then turn the camera on. And that was supposed to work, or restarting the program, or restarting the computer, or taking the battery out. And all of these things were supposed to be the solution. And then I ended up switching over to Capture One, and magically all of these connection problems disappeared and things worked rather flawlessly, and I was very happy for that. But over time, especially after I got the R5, this started happening once again. And somewhere in there, somebody said the reason why I was having these connection problems with Lightroom was because the program was trying to read all the images on the disk and it wasn't establishing the connection for me to shoot until it was done doing whatever it was doing in the background, looking at the pictures on my disk. I'm not saying that it was like reading them for some nefarious purpose, just that it was sort of perhaps preparing to take them into an import step or something. I really have no idea. So I started having, fast forward a year later, I started having these connection problems in Capture One. So I replaced that short cable. I still had the problems. I then, they were really intermittent problems. And so a lot of times it would work and then sometimes it wouldn't work and it was rather frustrating. I then went and was teaching at WPPI and it worked in the first part of my session and then it stopped working and it was really embarrassing because I had to go to a wireless network and transfer JPEGs. So when I got home from WPPI, I bought a long cable thinking that my long cable had a short in it, but I connected it all together and it didn't work. So I couldn't get a connection in Capture One and I kept getting this error. And so then I had a commercial shoot the next day and I got there and I ended up doing a thing where I was writing small JPEGs and RAW files to the camera and having those RAW files transfer to the computer wirelessly with EOS Utility and then have them auto import into Capture One, it was a complete and utter mess. But then the next night I had a shoot with a regular headshot client and I was trying to troubleshoot it. And I remember back to that guy telling me that if you took the cards out in Lightroom, things would work. So I popped the cards out in my R5 while I was connected to Capture One, and instantly the camera and the computer connected. So as it turns out, Capture One must also be looking at what's on the disc and trying to figure it out. And I think the reason why I didn't experience this problem at first with the program was because I had a 5D Mark IV and I didn't have 512 gigabyte cards, and I didn't have, you know, two big cards in the camera with a bunch of pictures on them from the last month. So if you run into these connection problems, look for those conflicts with other programs, and maybe, just maybe, take the disc out of your camera and it will solve it. So thank you guys so much for your time. Stay safe, have a great day, and I'll talk to you soon.